Okay, I'll start with you, Alex.
Thank you very much.
How did you discover Pink Floyd?
A good question. We were at boarding school together, and I think we were both listening to it quite a lot when it first came out.
Which one? It was the first album
this
you
album,
heard?
This particular album, Dark Side of the Moon.
But before that, we got into More and Sorcerer of Secrets, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it goes so far back. That's, I do remember taking my first LSD trip to Dark Side of the Moon, if that makes any relevance whatsoever to anyone.
How are the visuals?
I think they were all in my ears at the time, yeah, sure.
It's
my ears
one.
Became my eyes, I think.
Yeah. And do you remember the first time you heard Pink Floyd?
I think it was around the same time. At our school, we had a converted coal cellar that we were allowed to put record players and cushions in. And we kind of dive in there at any free time and just play music. And we really got into music there because it was very remote. Place and couldn't go out.
And it was also the only time that we could actually listen to anything of freedom, and our choice of freedom was music, even then.
Yeah. So they became, I mean, I don't think we were taking LSD then. Or even smoking pot, maybe a tiny bit, but the music itself really gave you a deep dive access into your unknown imagination and subconscious, and if you felt kind of a little bit holed up and trapped as we did, it was a fantastic portal out of that space.
It was also an album that gave you the chance to escape from the totalitarian that was our boarding school at the time.
And
a blueprint maybe for Ultra Worlds at the same point, which came much later.
And then I suppose Floyd, you know, pioneered along with a few other artists the sort of breaking away from 3 to 4 minute straightforward songs with long atmospheric build-ups. I mean, Dark Side of the Moon really was the first album since Syd Barrett era Floyd where they went back to songs in a way.
That's right, yeah, because if you think about metal, that whole side with Echoes was that long, long, long jam, and it almost seems like it was kind of simplified.
That's all side one, isn't it? You know, so they pioneered the big atmospheric thing, along with other, you know, German bands, Kraftwerk, Tangerine Dream, but in a way, it reminds me of, like, when I produced Urban Hymns, which has just come up to its 20th anniversary for the Verve.
Oh my gosh, that's 20 years old.
That was actually their third album. And the first two albums were, again, very psychedelic, long, jam-based things. And they got to a point of maturity as artists where they wanted to put that in, wrap it around some songs, and had a huge album. And it's kind of what happened with The Floyd as well, I think, with Dark Side of the Moon. They come out of an experimental light and sound show, you know, so putting it around songs was a challenge, but they really mastered it on Dark Side of the Moon, I think, you know, because you got the songs, but you've got these long instrumental passages.
And it's got a continuity, and it is definitely an album that all those tracks work with each other on that album.
Yeah, it's kind of a concept. We were talking about it earlier, that Alex says a bit of a concept album to it, although maybe it wasn't intentionally written as that.
We're going to find out a little bit later with Nick Mason, I think, but from what I've read, that Roger Waters did have some kind of concept in mind, but they were the themes of the everyday person rather than, well, maybe also a little bit of rich rock stars as well with songs like Money. But it was about themes that everybody could relate to and very kind of candid, direct lyrics as well. Mm. Even the simplicity of the music, it makes it very accessible, you know. Now, it's interesting we're talking about albums rather than songs, because when you started to listen to The Dark Side of the Moon and their subsequent albums, did you listen to these as albums? As opposed to just, oh, let me just listen to this song, or and maybe sample that one.
Well, I think that was predominant part of the culture then was to hear the whole album. The thing is, you'd have to get up and turn the record over after side one. But, you know, today with streaming culture, it is more about tracks. But albums still significant. I think albums will always be there as a volume of work that people can get their head around. We certainly listened to it as an album, I think. But there were tracks that jumped out, like Money and stuff, you know.
But did this also inspire the adventures of the Orb's Adventures Beyond the Ultra World? Because when I got that album, I listened to it as an album.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, that was the idea. It said so on the box with Ultra World. Individually, some tracks stand out a lot more on Ultra World, as much as Money stands out as a single track on. But Money doesn't sound out like Fluffy Clouds does on Ultra World. That's only because of my ears.
And my, the sleeve was more a nod to time, animals, really, because we lived in Battersea. Yeah,
the first time. First time I went to America. That was deliberate. It was Who the lives in Battersea was born there? I wonder. First time I went to Chicago, it was in the middle of a house revolution. And the first tune I heard when I got out of the cab on just outside the metro, it was Money by Pink Floyd. It really threw me. It was what I expected to be hearing.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's got an omnipresence about it, the whole album. It fits in. It's been part of everybody's culture. A dear family friend, when he was buried a couple of years ago, he got buried in one of those coffins, the Dark Side of the Moon coffin. The whole thing can mean so much to so many different people at so many different levels. And Dark Side of the Moon, I think, is also one of those albums that fits anyone who's got a little bit wobbly in the head, it calms them down.
Absolutely.
Really does. It's like Mozart for the 1970s. So anyway.
Yeah. You're about to say something, you.
Well, I think when we were making Ultra World and some of the early things, we weren't specifically going, oh, let's make it sound like Pink Floyd. But actually, in hindsight, it sounds a bit like that. It's weird, actually. When I was doing Endless River, which was really a homage to Rick Wright, we were going back through all the tapes from the 90s album that were sourced, that a lot of the tracks were sourced from and Rick's parts were on. And the problem we had there was that a lot of that album and the outtakes sounded more like The Orb than The Orb sounded like Pink Floyd. And David's brief to me was like, make it sound more like Pink Floyd. And that's because they made that around the same time we made Ultra World. So they were starting to use some of the same technology we were using, and I can't say they were influenced by it, but there's certain elements about it that are very orb-like as well. So there's a funny kind of twist to that discussion, really.
I mean, the orb being called the Pink Floyd of the 90s. I wonder if Pink Floyd had been called the orb of the noughties.
Well,
do you
I doubt
think?
It. But I think there is that like reciprocal sort of influence a little bit. Certainly
absolutely.
On Endless River, we could detect it.
But the orb did do a tune called Backside of the Moon.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And we did John Peel sessions where we were mixing in bits of Wish You Were Here and stuff.
And that was actually granted permission because one of our old school friends, amongst all this sort of, we know all these different people, Guy Pratt became the bass player, replaced Roger Waters, but he went to the same school as us two.
That's right.
And so when we sampled Wish You Were Here for the Peel session, we got clearance straight away from Pink Floyd because of Guy's connection.
Oh, wow.
Rather than having to go through management, we went straight to the source. And if there's any musicians in here, I suggest you talk to other musicians if you're going to sample anything. Yeah. Did I say that word?
Speaking of sampling, did you guys do that limited limited edition trance remix of Dark Side of the Moon? Because there's a lot of stuff on the internet about this. And some people have said, they've definitely done it. And other people have said they definitely haven't. Can we just put that to bed right now?
No, it's nothing to do with
nothing us. Nothing to do with us. It was a certain Mr. James Bond who lived in Soho at the time. I did research it and wanted to find out who was putting it out. Mm. Someone was taking the mickey, calling himself James Bond.
Yeah.
Mm. She might have been 007, really, but still.
Because some people still believe it, actually.
Well, unfortunately, you only have to listen to it. On paper, it sounds great, doesn't it? But the actual sound of it isn't that great.
I agree. I listened to it and thought, that doesn't sound like the orb at all.
Me and my partner went back and listened to it, Money and Fluffy Clouds put together, and it was insulting.
Yeah, we wouldn't
do that.
Yeah, it was awful.
Give me a much better job than that, surely.
Now, with Pink Floyd, I mean, it's not that as if the orb really sounds like Pink Floyd, but you definitely occupy a similar space for music fans. I think that's probably a better way of putting it. Would you agree?
Yeah, for sure. I mean,
that's a nice way of putting it. Yeah. It's hard to define what the appeal of Pink Floyd is, as opposed to, Led Zeppelin or other 70s bands. They did occupy their own space that had a lot of atmosphere to it, doesn't it? And I think also the criteria of Pink Floyd from, early on, and especially with Dark Side of the Moon, for production criteria and sonic criteria, became a benchmark of production excellence. And so we were certainly influenced by that and wanting to attain the highest possible quality of what we were doing and have that hi-fi, immersive experience when you listen to the album on headphones or something like that. Music that you could journey to and get in touch with your imagination. The great thing about Dark Side of the Moon, I think, is lyrically, the lyrics are quite ambiguous, even though there's some specifics. There's a lot of, ambiguity and enigma in them, and that allows you as a listener to apply them to your own experience in a much easier way than if it was really specific narrative. Mm-hmm. So, their lyrics are suggestive, but they're also dealing with darker elements of, people's life, mental health, madness. That's a common thread in Dark Side of the Moon.
The conflicts of being a human, almost.
Yeah, and also the recurring
muse.
Having
to do with being a human.
For them as writers of Syd Barrett, which again recurred with, Wish You Were Here. But
see you on the dark side of the moon.
Yeah. I think a lot of not only artists, but a lot of people can relate to those issues.
You were talking earlier about the production values, and of course Alan Parsons engineered this album. What do you think of him as an engineer?
Well, Alan's a legend, isn't he? Mainly from that album. But he wasn't the only engineer on that album. And
Chris Thomas did the mix.
Chris Thomas. I mean, let's talk about Chris Thomas, because Chris Thomas is a living genius, I think. He not only mixed Dark Side of the Moon, he mixed Nevermind the Bollocks, and he mixed the White Album. So he did three decades worth of number ones, really.
And they're all very, very different.
Very, very different. But still, what an incredible talent that man is,
Also, I think part of his function when he was doing the mix was to kind of be a mediator between Gilmour and Waters, from what I understand, because Gilmour really wanted everything drenched in reverb and quite wet, and Waters wanted things much more dry and the vocals right up front. And so he had to kind of find a happy medium, so it's kind of good to have a third party in there rather than the band just fighting amongst themselves.
Well, that's one of the great dynamics, like Jagger Richards is, Roger and David. And I think you get that in the album. There's a polarized juxtaposition of two very different philosophies having to find their middle ground. And that's often what makes fantastic albums, is those extreme personalities, you know, somehow finding their balance.
And galvanizing the music the creativity. Now, the Orbs live shows, I remember seeing the Orb for the first time, I guess it was at the Marquee in New York City. Must have been around 91 or 92. And it was really incredible because I remember there was like this, you were almost like, looked like the stage was like an igloo. Everything was like white and you guys were behind these kind of white kind of facades. And then you had projections as well.
Projections on the orbs.
I mean, this is a long time ago, sure. People. And I'm doing pretty well remembering it was at the Marquee. So, I mean, did Pink Floyd inspire you because... You know, they were one of the first bands to really incorporate... I mean, we obviously the Dead did it with the Joshua Light show, but they were one of the... Probably the first British band, possibly, or one of the first British bands of that magnitude to incorporate a visual element into their live shows.
Well, it's interesting that, you know, the Summer of Love kind of kicked off simultaneously San Francisco and London, 67. It's an interesting debate at who was first, but there were actually people ping-ponging between the two. In London, you had Joe Boyd and John Hopkins, Hoppy, who started the UFO Club, which had these all-night projections. It went all night. Soft Machine and Pink Floyd were the in-house bands. Pink Floyd, David told me at the beginning, was... actually a sound and light installation. So, Storm mentioned to me when I was asking him about the sleeves that they all had a relation to the sound and light installation origins of Floyd. So the part, the visual aspect of the light, half the band was the light show, basically. Yeah. And so the band were in shadows behind the light show. Now, that coincided at the end of the 80s with Acid House, beginnings of Goa Trance, so DJs would be hidden and you'd have this big light show. And the Orb really, I think, were influenced by Floyd in that way to have this phenomenal light show going on with a few shadowy people on stage. And that's what it was in the early 90s.
I mean, we relied visually, that's what we did rely on. We didn't have a singer, we didn't have a guitarist. And we just wanted to blind people with visuals that were as good as the music, that went with the music. Yeah. Spent a lot of time, and still working with the same people, actually, visually. Gary Oldman from Deep Visuals. 30 years of experience next year.
So. Interesting. So it is kind of like that family, like Pink Floyd. I mean, Storm Thorgerson was almost like a fifth member of the band, and they'd work with similar light show people for a long time. So it's a collaborative relationship. It's not just, we have this new album, we'll get anybody.
Yeah, but we kind of, when we started off in the back room of Heaven, it was the chill out lounge. It was something that, in my head, it was something like the Milk Bar in Clockwork Orange. It was that kind of mentality as opposed to the 1960s. Yeah.
And we took over, the DJ before we started doing our residency was Hippie, who was this old hippie who played Soft Machine. And it was very, they had a Royal Wheels. It was like the UFO Club then. Mm-hmm. But of course, the Floyd Live, the light show, still is phenomenal. And The Wall, which is probably considered one of the most best live shows ever. I think they brought... the producer of The Wall was the Canadian producer. He produced all the Alice Cooper albums.
Bob Ezrin,
that's it.
Yeah,
they brought him in, interestingly, he told me, to produce the live show as well. And on that live show, they kind of did things. I think there's a competition then and now, even with the Beatles and Floyd, to do things that hadn't been done before. And on that live show, they began building the wall in front of the band as they played. But when the band came on, there was another band with masks on of the band that played as they came on. And then they sank down under the stage. And then there was this other band. And everybody was like, well, who's the real band? You know, is it them or these guys? And so they really, you know, they had the vision to bring in Bob to help make that show work, and visually and sonically. And it's a very few bands I know that will go that extra, that distance to make something that special. And we know Floyd always really have done that, you know.
I think and do you feel The Orb to some degree has done that as well? I mean, maybe not a show like The Wall that ambitious, but as far as it's not just the music, it's more the whole concept in a sense. And also I like the whole point of like becoming almost anonymous and detached.
Well, yeah, we did do a tour with a Pyramid when at the time of just before Cydonia, which did have a Pyramid with a great seal with a Pyramid balanced on its nose. Does that sound familiar to an American? But it was actually just a seal with a Pyramid balanced on its nose. But that's another story. But we were touring inside a Pyramid, and it was a time when Chemical Brothers had just started, and they were getting quite upset because we were playing inside a Pyramid for too long, and by the time they went on stage, the crowd had gone home. Now, what would you say was going to happening at that particular point? You can't win. I mean, they were supporting us, and we let them go on next at last. It was quite an amusing moment. But they didn't have any idea of why we were inside a Pyramid. Still.
But it's a good point, because if you look at big electronic artists now, you know, like even Daft Punk or something, they play in a Pyramid, don't they? And the light show for those artists is really important. And that's certainly been direct influence from Pink Floyd.
So their legacy lives on, not just in like any kind of prog rock or rock sphere, also dance music.
Absolutely,
and any kind of electronic music.
Yeah, indeed, yeah.
Now, I've been listening a lot to Metallic Spheres recently, which is a great album. And this came out, the Orb's album, in 2010, which features David Gilmour. How did that come about?
That came about... I'd been doing something with David and suggested it. And
what were you doing with David?
I can't remember. It was...
Yeah, was it Paul McCartney or is it David Gilmour?
Might be, yeah. I mean, yeah, they're friends. And the conversation came about a collaboration.
You pulled a really good one, Youth, actually. We started off as a single idea, and then Youth went, he's given us so many guitar licks, let's do an album.
Yeah, that was it, yeah.
Basically.
Yeah, and that's production.
And then, yeah. then pushed it over to the Gilmour's management and...
I'd worked with David before, actually, on Blue Pearl, because this is a funny story. I'd gone to see Floyd in Venice in 86, 87, and Guy was, I think it was Guy's first tour, and he'd invited us over, and I got so smashed with my mates, I kind of missed half the gig. Watched the rest of it on this balcony that Duran Duran had booked from their hotel. It was an unreal night. And afterwards, they had the after party, because they were playing on these pontoons by St. Mark's Square. It's absolutely amazing show, the bit I saw. And and then they had the party on the Lido Island where they filmed Death in Venice. And I got to the party and met Durga McBroom, who was one of the backing singers. And I said to her, come to London, I'll make you a star. You know, you're fantastic.
He actually said it. He did say those words. And you know what? He did as well.
And she, 2 weeks later, she rang me up. She said, I'm here. I'm ready.
I'm ready to be a star.
Yeah. And I just got a track going. And I said, okay, come down. And it wasn't specifically for her. It was just kind of a KLFE trancey thing, actually. And I ended up getting Jimmy to do a keyboard on it. And Durga wrote and put a top line on it in like half an hour. And that became Take Me Dancing Naked and Away, a big, really big single for her. And on the album of that, David very kindly, and Rick and Guy, did some cameo parts on the album. So I'd worked with David a bit before. And but on the Metallic Spheres was really great, because I kind of really got in depth with him. And a bit like working with McCartney, it's like, you don't want to kind of draw your influences or suggestions too close to where they are from, or where, you know. So I wouldn't use any Floyd references on that, but I might reference stuff he was into. So, for example, on Metallic Spheres, there's one track where I said, "Oh, do you like Hank Marvin?" I knew he liked Hank Marvin, but I said, "Oh, do you like
the Shadows?"
I'm hungry.
And he goes, "Do I like Hank Marvin?" Grabbed his guitar and started playing all these Hank Marvin. I said, "Let's do an overdub, like, you know." Sometimes with musicians, artists, you go, you know, what about like Everly Brothers as a backing vocal? You go to their influences rather than them. Yes. And they immediately engage in that because that's what they grew up with. That's what they're fans of. And David, it was a really good approach with David. He really kind of dived in and enjoyed doing that. And so you get some really interesting ideas. And that developed a good working relationship with him.
And did he reveal any of his influences? Was it Hank Marvin? I guess Hank Marvin influenced every British guitarist that was coming of age in the 1960s. But were there any other influences?
Yeah. Well, I mean, we were both big fans of Soft Machine as well, Robert Wyatt. And, you know, so there were things like that were coming up a lot. And the Beatles, of course. He's a big fan of the Beatles. So, but he was also, you know, he's a very good guitarist, obviously. But when he was in the 60s, he had a big repertoire of stuff he used to do with Joker's Wild and stuff like that. So you could reference stuff and you'd actually know the songs, you know. So it's quite easy to, you know, pinpoint specifics. Yeah.
Is he relaxed in the studio?
He is relaxed. But, you know, sometimes those artists that look really calm on the outside, there's this inner turmoil inside. And I think, you know, I don't know David that well, but there's an intensity to him that belies the
detached, removed veneer.
Yeah, the laid back, smooth. You know, he's archetypally English, so you can never really know what he's thinking. You know,
yeah, it's taken me a few years to learn that. Yeah. Alex, what did you feel about Metallic Spheres? Did you think it was a real meeting of the orb and Pink Floyd, or was it a dream come true for you?
In many ways, I think we could have gone a lot further with it, but it was something that you just don't turn down in your lifetime, is it, really?
Mm. I listened to it a couple of days ago, actually, and it sounded amazing.
Yeah, there are tunes that you just pull out and listen to in different contexts. I kind of had a different meeting with... I mean, I was, as we've already mentioned, that we'd been cited as the Pink Floyd of the 90s by a certain record press. And the Melody Maker put us two on the front cover of one edition, so I had to go have a photo shoot with David Gilmour for the first time I met him.
Yeah, that was good.
Yeah, and he just talked to me about aeroplanes and propellers. It really threw me. No idea, mate. And my dad was in the RAF. Yeah. That's as far as it goes with me.
But
can't fly.
When you fly in other ways, Alex.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Around the time of Metallic Spheres, there was a conversation or two about us potentially doing a gig with David, and we were talking about doing it. And that's Area
still,
51.
That can still happen.
Yeah, in the desert.
He still owes us that. I shouldn't really let that lie.
You have my number now, so. I definitely want guest list for that. We mentioned that you produced the last Pink Floyd album, The Endless River, but I didn't really get a chance to ask you what it was like working on that, because you were working with Nick and with David on this, and listening to a lot of Richard Wright's keyboard parts. And what was that experience like?
Absolutely phenomenal. I mean, I've always had, you know, one of the reasons I suspect I'm so driven as a producer or as an artist is because, you know, I've had a lot of insecurities. I'm self-taught, came up from the sort of DIY punk, post-punk era. And it was only when I was working with them, I think it was only a few years ago, that I suddenly thought, well, actually, I am a producer now because I'm working with Pink Floyd. So it gave me a lot of confidence. I mean, it was a pretty intense gig as well because their criteria is intense. But as we progressed through and it started to come together, gave me a lot of confidence in what I do. And then when we finished it and it came out, it kind of really did sort of make me feel like I am a bona fide producer now. and it was an incredible experience. I learned so much from working with David and the team.
What did you learn?
Well, I learned just, you know, that it's worth really going those extra miles when you have to. And that often the shortcuts are actually deadly elephant traps. So, you know, to be patient and just keep pushing that bar further and higher. And really just be kind of relaxed about it. I mean, David was very relaxed in the way he works, but it's very, very laser-sharp focused as well. And it's the combination, again, on juxtaposition of those two opposites that creates that magic balance, you know. It's a mystery. But, yeah, I mean, it was really, you know, breathtaking, spine-tingling experience.
I bet. Yeah. Now, back to The Dark Side of the Moon. Is this your favorite Pink Floyd album?
Mine's juggles between Source of Full Secrets and Wish You Were Here.
Metal.
Metal?
Metal.
Echoes fan? One of these days. I used to play One of These Days.
It's Echoes, really. Echoes. Yeah. And the dog track, because that always gets me.
Yeah. And more.
Is why, if there was an Arsenal fan in the band, why did they do the Liverpool chanting on it?
Because David's an Arsenal fan, isn't he?
Yeah,
but it's a Liverpool chant. But why?
Well, where do you see the Dark Side of the Moon sitting in the Pink Floyd canon?
Oh, it's certainly, you know, such a significant record, isn't it?
250,000 miles away on the other side of it.
I like that answer. Yeah.
You know, they kind of went more avant-garde with, you know, Amhart Mother and stuff with the sound collage and them having breakfast. And, but I think you still have that in Dark Side of the Moon. Dark Side of the Moon wrapped, you know, had those songs. It's those songs.
They pulled the element of what everybody was as psychedelic into four-minute, three-minute songs.
Yeah.
And they created a whole series of them that interlinked together.
Yeah, and it's.
And no other album does that.
It's so sublime the way the band use a lot of restraint in the way they play and a lot of restraint in, as you said earlier, it's not too cluttered. It's quite simple what's going on. To achieve that simplicity is very, very hard. Mm. Yeah. And then you've got the On the Run, which is this sort of synthesizer sort of masterpiece of psychedelia. And then you've got Great Gig in the Sky, which is this absolute piano masterpiece of Rick's. Could have been, you know, written by Bach or someone. I mean, it's just one of the most beautiful pieces of music ever written, I think. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, those cornerstones, I mean, it's just formidable, isn't it, you know?
And Alex, any favourite moments on The Dark Side of the Moon for you?
As I say, but going back to pre-art school and listening to Pink Floyd and Transformer, on LSD for the first time. Sorry, they were moments. They were definitely moments. You know, I'm not denying it. Mm-hmm. We're all on LSD, but nobody realises it, surely.
It's one of those albums that actually gets you high without you having to take any drugs, which is an incredible achievement.
I agree. I mean, the bands weren't doing anything really in the studio, and they had to really be on it to be so precise and focused and to... That's their story.
Well,
so.
It's a psychedelic masterpiece, isn't it? Yeah. The irony there is that the actual band at the time were the least psychedelic band you could imagine as people, you know, architects.
Playing cricket against the Abbey Road staff. And
it's interesting, you know, if you think of America, you know, like Grateful Dead is probably considered the great psychedelic American band. But they don't sound that psychedelic to me. I mean, actually, Floyd sounds psychedelic, but weren't. Whereas the Dead don't sound psychedelic but were.
Well, when you see them live, that's not at all kind of makes sense. Yeah. Slapstick, so I felt about the same way as you.
Yeah.
Well, it's really incredible to think that an album that considers such weighty themes as insanity, religion, greed, mortality, and the need for human empathy became one of the most classic albums of all time, selling a cool 50 million records. It was released during the height of glam rock, and the critical response wasn't too favorable, but as always, the fans made up their own minds, and The Dark Side of the Moon staked its place in the charts for nearly 15 years. Waters, the chief lyricist and conceptualist of the album, later recalled, "It was about all the pressures and difficulties and questions that crop up in one's life and create anxiety, and the potential you have to solve them or to choose the path that you're going to walk." Engineered, as we said, by Alan Parsons and Abbey Road's 16-track analog studio, the album was groundbreaking in its technical ambition with the use of the VCS3 synthesizer, tape loops, sound effects, and spoken word that all added further depth, atmosphere, and almost a new subplot to the album. It also featured beautifully crafted and emotive melodies that reinforce the direct simplicity of the lyrics. The iconic album cover, of course, is just as straightforward. Storm Thorgerson wanted to make it simple, bold, and dramatic, and later said the triangle was a symbol for greed and ambition, and also the newfound order and focus in their work. The prism has since become one of the most identifiable images in popular culture. The album was released on the 23rd of March in 1973, and still to this day, it has a contemporary feel, not only sonically, but also thematically. It's themes that concerns everyone. People still feel these things today, and it really still connects. And that may be why it's still one of the best-selling albums of all time. So in a second, we're going to hear it on 5.1 on this Neumann speaker sound system installed by Sennheiser. And I ask that you refrain from any conversation and that you have your phones on silent or off. And thank you so much, Youth, and thank you so much, Alex, for joining us.
Thanks for having us.
Let's have a listen.